I'm back here with the Xiaomi Mi Notebook. So this I have been using for the last almost 2 weeks, and it's the budget version, cut down version, where they did cut some definite corners compared to the Mi Notebook Pro model. So we have a metal lid on this one, alloy. That's the only metal you're going to get on this particular model. Now there's no flex when you push down hard on this. The hinge is good on this, and we do have rubber around the outside, giving it a very quality feel to it. The build is excellent, and we do have, yes, larger bezels, much larger than my Mi Notebook Pro here, because they want you to go for, if you want the slimmer bezels, go for the more expensive model. Now this model is far superior in many ways. It has a much better GPU, it has double the RAM, the configuration, and much faster SSD with double the size storage. So it makes sense to go for this one with the larger battery. But this particular model here does have some pros going for it, the fact that you can upgrade many components, which I will show you shortly. So the keyboard, typing on this keyboard is very good. Once I got accustomed to the slightly more crammed in style of it, because we've got the full number pad on here, typing on this keyboard, there is very little flex on that, and I do like it. It's not backlit like we get with the Pro model as well. So, you know, there's a lot of things and reasons why you would get that model over this one, but if you want to save money, then this is one to go for. So palm rest, plastic, and yes, it does show up fingerprints, but I feel it's going to hold up a lot better than the paint job that we get with the metal and the alloy on the Mi Notebook Pro. That is already showing on the palm rest some fading on my unit after about 8 months of use, which is not good. You're not going to get it with this. So the touchpad is the same size. This is using Windows Precision Drivers. It's a good touchpad. It is really the same touchpad as this one, minus, of course, the fingerprint reader in that. Now, overall, build-wise, it is good, well put together. And when we take a look at the internals, you can see that this is where things get a lot better. We've got slightly better cooling on this one. The fans come on a lot less. The thermals are actually much better. And I really do like the fan profiles, the fan noise on this one. You don't get an irritating fan that comes on now and then just with light tasks, which happens on the Mi Notebook Pro. Not here. So upgradable RAM, you can upgrade the wireless cards, are great for Hackintosh. And you can also swap out and put in even a larger terabyte drive. So 2 terabytes if you wanted to, or even 4 I think you can get now for 2.5 inch drives. But because they put that 2.5 inch drive in here, we do have a massive compromise with the battery capacity, which is really quite annoying. So 41 watt hours instead of 60 you get on the Pro. And in my testing, this means battery life is terrible. We're only getting 3.5 hours to 4. So that is not great at all. Now for ports, we get a couple more ports on this, which is good, but we don't have Type C. So on the right hand side, we have gigabit LAN, something that's missing on the Pro model, 2 USB 3 ports, and we also have an HDMI port on here, which is only 1.4 spec. Now, I wish it was HDMI 2. I believe that everyone needs to start using HDMI 2 spec now in 2018. And then, of course, a 3.5 millimeter headphone jack there. Now, the output out of this headphone jack is good, clear sound, it supports a microphone, and the loudness is decent as well there. Then on the right hand side, we have DC in, so no Type-C charging for this one. Charge times are close to about 3 hours, so it's not as fast. A USB 2 port here, great to have this on the right hand side for you right-handed people out there like myself. Now the SD card reader, it is only USB 2 spec, so it's not the fastest here. And then when you look at the weight of both of these, so this model, the plastic's a little bit heavier. It comes out to be 2.2 kilos. And then we have the Pro model, which is still heavy, is 2 kilos there. So there is a 200 gram difference there in weight, but you get the better cooling on this model, less fan noise, and of course you can upgrade the RAM and all the rest of the components.
So now to focus on that screen, it is an IPS panel and it is 1080p, matte coated, anti-glare. It's an okay screen. I have seen better and I have seen worse. So I mean, viewing angles, typical IPS, that it is actually gonna be perfectly fine. I mean, they could have gone with a TN panel, which would be really bad, and I'm thankful that they did not do that. So when you take a look at the color reproduction, it is okay. It's not really the greatest. So this is not a screen for professional use, and I'll show you the reason why. Because when you have a look at the Adobe RGB percent here, so I've measured this with my Spider 5 Pro, you get 48% Adobe RGB coverage, which is not great. So that's not a lot there. And then when it comes to your sRGB, that's 65% of sRGB. Now the maximum brightness is around about 200 lux, so it's not the brightest screen. Now at the moment I have it set somewhere at about 50%, which I use for indoor use. In fact, that was less. It's about 30% there. And there it is at its 200 lux, which is, it's ideal. That's fine. It's actually perfectly fine for indoor use. You're not going to have any problems with it at all. And it does dim down really quite dim. Now that shimmering, that flickering you're seeing right now, this is pulse width modulation, but it's only being captured on camera here. I can't see that with my own eyes here in person. Now, if you haven't seen my unboxing video, I went ahead and upgraded the RAM because my model only came with 4 gigabytes of RAM, and really that's not enough, especially with this spec. So our CPU is the i5-8250U, and you can get the i7-8550U, which has a higher turbo. That one goes up to 4 gigahertz, and this one here maxes out at 3.6, I think it is. So you get 400 megahertz more. Now, I do recommend, if you can, to put in more RAM. Of course, it's going to help improve the performance. Now, it came with Windows 10 in Chinese. So what I did here, you don't have to do this. You can do a clean install. It'll pull through the Windows, the key that is in the BIOS, and it will activate then. You just have to install Windows 10 Home. But I upgraded to Pro for the purposes of my review to keep the original drivers and to keep the recovery partition. So when you upgrade to Pro, that then allows you to install an English language pack. So it comes with a Samsung SSD that is SATA 3, 128 gigabytes. You get about 98 or about 100 or so gigabytes free. Not a lot of space. Of course, you've got the 1 terabyte drive. Now that 1 terabyte drive is about 110 megabytes reads and writes sequential. And when you look at these speeds of the SSD, they are fine for a SATA 3 SSD. No problems. Remember, if you want faster and more storage, then I highly recommend going for something like a Samsung 970 Evo that costs about 100 euros, and you can get the 256 gigabyte version, and that will really give you super performance. That's when you get about 3,500 reads and about 1,500 writes sequential. So the Cinebench R15 scores here, you can see 705 CB is not bad at all when you think of this as being about a 580, 600 US laptop. That performance is good. It's a decent CPU because it's quad core, it has 8 threads, and that's the OpenGL score as well, which, you know, is not as fast as the MX150 you get in the Mi Notebook Pro. That GPU is about twice as fast. So this is the Firestrike score here for the MX110. Now, I did manage to do a little bit of overclocking. So this is an overclock score here. This is the best that you're about to squeeze out of this. So the Maxwell architecture does overclock pretty good. It always has for the desktops, and the same goes here with the laptops. So I managed to get 135 to the core clock and then 920 on the RAM clock. And this is boosting it up, probably giving us about 10%, 15% extra frames per second, depending on what kind of game that you are playing. And for those that are interested, here is the Passmark 9 rating. So 3,546 here. The weakness being the GPU there, and well, the SSD is not as fast, of course, as the NVMe one we get in the Mi Notebook Pro. Now, when you look at general performance of the laptop, it's as expected for a Core i5 with the 4 cores, 8 threads. It's fast, and with my 16 gigabytes of RAM, of course, I can do plenty of multitasking. So streaming 4K video here in Chrome, not a problem, no issues whatsoever, no drop frames. So your day-to-day general performance is really good. I don't need to really go through this because everything opens up really fast, even with a SATA 3 SSD. So scrolling performance in Edge is really good, no issues there. Everything opened up, Office, Docs, Excel, really quite quick, no problems, especially with me running the 16 gigabytes of RAM. So I've already shown you the Cinebench result. I just wanted to quickly play back here a high encoded bitrate file. So this one's the Jellyfish. This is 140 megabits per second, 4K 10-bit HEVC, and this plays absolutely flawlessly fine, no problems. Skip ahead, that's all going to be quick. So the performance you get out of the Core i5 here, an 8th generation chip, even though it is the lower voltage one, is really very quick, very fast, and everyone's going to be pleased with it. So I am doing a little bit of editing here. This is 4K. And it runs fine. Now, this is because I do have that 16 gigabytes of RAM. So bear that in mind. If you were to do this with just the 4 gigabytes that this model originally had, then it would be a completely different story here. So it is keeping up fine. It is not a problem here. The timeline, when you're looking at the preview screen, this is all in real time. I'll just quickly scroll through to show you that it's keeping up fine. No issues there. I've noticed that when you resize some of the windows here, you do get a little bit of lag that comes into play there. Now, very large edits, and sometimes I do edits up to about 25 minutes, I'll notice that it will start to slow down a little, but overall it is pretty good. And I will show you now here with Intel's XTU, that I've done a little bit of a tweak here to the power limits as well. So I've undervolted 0.09, and I've increased the power limit to 45 watts there, so that's helping. And you'll see later on when I do my encode that it's going to hold that turbo without any problems. The thermals are perfectly fine, and the fan noise is also very good. So that's great. So what I'm going to do now is do my test here, 1 minute of footage. I'm going to export that with the YouTube 4K preset. We'll see how long it takes to do that. Okay, so it's going to take just over a minute or so, but do remember that Adobe Premiere Pro now does feature the hardware acceleration, so I think it's using NVIDIA's QuickSync to really bolster up the speeds here. So once that finally finishes, I'll hit pause. Once the 100% bar disappears. So there we go, about 1 minute and 19 seconds to encode 1 minute of the 4K YouTube preset, which is not bad at all. Aside from the battery, this here, of course, is the other weakness. The NVIDIA MX110, which is basically just a rebadged, relabeled 920MX, so it's quite a weak GPU, but at least it does have double data rate 5. There is another version of this particular chipset, well, the 920M, that only has a double data rate 3, and it is really crippled. This means older titles, you can see here, this is Skyrim. This is on the medium preset, we're getting around 50 frames per second. So this is not a super fast GPU, but at least, I mean, you can get away with playable frame rates in 1080p here. Now if I start to pick a fight with some of the guards, you'll see that that frame rate is going to drop down a little. So you do expect dips of under 40 frames per second, depending on what's going on, if there's a lot on screen. You can see now 35 frames per second, so it will get laggy at times here. But let's test out a lighter title, League of Legends. So you can see it's running this one on the very high setting. Perfectly fine, really good frame rate here. So it's hovering around 150, 160 frames per second. Not an issue. This is a very light title, of course, though. So a lot of hardware can play this. You don't need a demanding machine to run this game. And GTA 5 here with normal settings, 1080p, is actually getting quite a decent frame rate. But again, bear in mind that I have overclocked that GPU quite a bit. So this is giving us about an extra 10 frames per second or so more. It is dipping down to mid-40s here. But overall, it still looks great actually on normal. And we're getting a very playable frame rate here, which is great considering the GPU that this has. And for those of you out there that still play Counter-Strike, it's running around 60 frames per second, and this is on the high preset, the very high setting, so this is fine. And after 3 hours now of pushing it, you can see these are the temperatures and max temps on the CPU, so 68 degrees. This is not bad. I mean, there's no thermal throttling that has been triggered here. And again, I'm running an increased power limit here of 45 watts, so I do recommend that because it's going to handle it just fine, the hardware. And then we move over now to take a look at the GPU. You can see that gets up then to a maximum of 66 degrees. So that's perfectly fine. Again, it is overclocked too. External temps as well are actually better than the Mi Notebook Pro. Probably because it's a thicker laptop and it has a little bit more space for cooling. So up the top here on the Mi Notebook Pro gets close to around 46 degrees. This one here you can see is 34, 36, 38. So it is a little bit cooler here. Now this is after about an hour of really pushing it quite hard, the system. The touchpad, that remains cool, 26 degrees, as well as the palm rests at all times, no matter what you're doing. Max fan noise tops out at 42 decibels, which is also quite good. I'll give you a sample of it now. So the laptop has two downwards firing speakers. They're 3 watt, but this time around they're not infinity tuned speakers. They don't sound as good as the Mi Notebook Pros, but they're okay. They're fairly decent and the loudness is also good. But here's a sample of them.
So
So here is a sample shot with the webcam that we get. So 720p max, and it's 30 frames per second. The quality is okay. It is almost identical, really, to the Mi Notebook Pros. I can't tell much of a difference between them. So we have dual array microphones, and they're up left and right of the actual webcam there as well. So there's a good location for them, I feel, because you're not going to get as much feedback from the keyboard. So when you're typing on the keys, you can hear that coming through a little bit there.
And for those of you that like to run Linux, well, it is running on here fine. We've got screen brightness control options. That's all working. The sound is working. The touchpad is working. But what is not working is the wireless card. It does not like this Realtek wireless card. The good thing is that you can, of course, swap it out and use one of the Intel ones that should be picked up with the drivers.
Okay, so quickly recapping here. So the obvious choice, if you don't have any issues with money that you can afford to get the $800 model, go for it. Of course, it's got so many things that are better for it. You get an NVMe SSD, you get double the RAM, you get better the speakers, fingerprint reader in here as well. It is 200 grams lighter. The list goes on, but then there's a lot of things I do like about this system here. So the biggest thing for me is you can upgrade a lot more components. So you can upgrade the RAM, which is really good. It has better cooling on here, so the fans come on way less. Most of the time, these fans are not on for light tasks. When with light tasks, even just surfing the internet with Chrome, the fans on this one come on and off, especially when you're on AC, they tend to come on a lot more. On the battery, it's not too bad. So you get, of course, a wireless card, you can change that. So if you were going to be buying one of these as a project for, say, setting up Hackintosh, then you can swap out that wireless. If you're not happy with the speed of it and you're running Windows as well, you could put one of these Intel Gigabit ones in there with Bluetooth 5, a lot faster than what is in there. You can add a 2.5-inch hard drive, and there are cheaper options as well for that. So you've got a terabyte of storage. So this comes with more storage, but you get the slow SSD, you get the faster one with this model here. Now the screen is another pro to me, unless of course you're editing on this, you need to do color grading, then this one's slightly more accurate, but still not a wonderfully accurate screen we have on the Mi Notebook Pro. So both of them aren't wonderful screens for color grading and things like that. You need to get a more expensive, better model of notebook for that with a better screen. But I feel for students, for business and things like that, the matte coated screen is just a lot more practical, less susceptible. You're not gonna have problems with reflections, glare. It is only 200 lux bright, and I feel that Xiaomi toned it down intentionally on purpose, that this panel will actually be able to be a lot brighter, but they've really toned that down to save on the battery life, which they probably know why they've done that, of course, is absolutely terrible. The biggest con with this laptop here, apart from the weak GPU, now a lot of people aren't gaming, so the GPU might not be a huge issue, that they cut down on the GPU, obviously saving money there, but the battery capacity, I feel that would have been better if they had ditched the 2.5-inch drive. I know a lot of people won't agree with me on this. And this would include another SATA, an M.2 drive. A SATA slot in there or NVMe would be better, I feel, and give us the 60-watt-hour battery, because the 60-watt-hour battery in the Mi Notebook Pro is good for up to about, I can get 8-9 hours sometimes out of this one, just running on integrated graphics. This, 3.5 to 4 hours, is just shocking. It's so bad, the battery life on this. I can't believe how bad it is and how Xiaomi pushed it out with such a small battery. Now, I thought 31 watt hours, yeah, 41 watt hours is not a lot, but I was hoping for at least 5 hours, six maybe, but to only get 4 hours, 4.5 tops, and that's with the brightness right down, terrible, which makes it really hard to recommend. Unless, of course, battery life for you isn't important, and what is more important is the upgradability that this machine has. So, end of the day, if you've got the cash, get this model. If you're on a budget, you need the upgradability. And then this is a decent notebook. As I said, the keyboard is good to type on. It has a large touchpad. The screen is good. Yeah, it's got the larger bezels. Build quality overall is typical Xiaomi. It's a very good build. It feels a lot more solid. The plastics on it are going to hold up a lot better than the metals here in the long run, because I noticed that the paint can chip on this one, and so this is really the machine to go for. Thank you so much for watching this review on Xiaomi's Mi Notebook, and I do hope to catch you back in the channel with more up and coming reviews. My latest videos are right up here, so check out those, and I will see you soon. Bye for now.